Hi, this is Anders Johansson from Tungsten, and you are watching That Metal Interview.
Our next guest is a complete legend by the name of Anders Johansson, drummer extraordinaire for many, many years, complete talent, has been a drummer for Malmsteen for three records or so, Hammerfall, and now Tungsten with two of his sons, and you guys have to check this out. Anyways, we are here to talk about his career and Tungsten's new record titled The Grand Inferno, Reigning Phoenix Music. And right now, let's check out their newest single and video by the title of Lullaby. Check it out.
To be me, I
Now, if that doesn't remind you of Rammstein, I don't know what that is. It's metal, for sure. And we talk about it on this chat with Anders. And to me, Anders is a legend because I first heard of his work with Yngwie Malmsteen on Trilogy, his album and work with Malmsteen, Odyssey, and Marching Out. Should I say in order, it would be Marching Out, Trilogy, and Odyssey. And I would say those are Yngwie Malmsteen's most famous records, sales-wise and everything else-wise. And anyways, that's where I first heard of Mr. Anders Johansson on the drums. Drummer, for you guys that don't know who I am talking about. And he later went on to become the drummer for Hammerfall and now Tungsten. And if that wasn't enough, he has an extraordinary, talented brother as well by the name of Jens Johansson, who also was the keyboardist for Yngwie Malmsteen and has been playing with Richie Blackmore's Rainbow for years now, amongst a bunch of projects, including Stratovarius. Anyways, let's go to the chat with Anders Johansson of Tungsten. Check it out. First question, Anders, where are you? What part of the planet Earth?
I'm in Sweden, in the south of Sweden, on the Swedish Riviera. It's not called that, but it's actually on the extreme south of Sweden, which is in North Europe, of course. And yeah, that's where I'm at.
Very cool. So how's the weather up there?
Well, it's pretty good. Where are you at, by the way?
I'm in Texas, the U.S.
Okay. The weather here is in Fahrenheit, I would say, maybe 70, maybe.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty warm for us. I mean, it rarely gets over 80, you know, that's rare. But we still have summer here, just like you guys. So,
nice.
I mean, I've been in Texas a lot of times, so I know how hot you guys can have it.
Yeah, it's horrible.
Way more than here.
Horrible. So let's speak about yourself a little bit, Anders, here before we get into your new album, We're Tungsten. I first heard of you as a rock fan. I heard of you with your Malmsteen work, Trilogy, Marching Out, Odyssey, you know, all that stuff. Great, great work you did there. So thanks for the great music there.
Oh, thank you. Oh, yeah, absolutely. That was, of course, a great time. Very special, because it was the first time for me doing it like professionally, kind of. And I remember when we came to Texas, it was like a big first time. It was like in Corpus Christi and where else was it? Austin, Dallas, and all that. It was unbelievably hot and humid and enormous thunderstorms that we never really seen here. I mean, it's quite the difference. And yeah, back then I was only like 21 and stuff, so it was kind of weird. We were children, more or less. Not really, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, kids, yeah.
And I came from the Swedish Navy. I wasn't there by choice. I was it was used to be mandatory here.
Okay.
So I was like an equivalent of a sergeant. It's actually one step below sergeant, but I tried to see what it was in English, but it's a lower rank sergeant or whatever. And coming to Ingolstadt from that situation, it was really strange, because Ingolstadt, it was nothing but military. It was like he was unbelievably loose, and rules didn't apply at all, and he was like really freaky almost. So first I thought this is unbelievable, but after a while I started, I mean, we all, you know, when the boss is like non-military style, you know, then of course everybody starts misbehaving, kind of.
Yeah.
So that was fun.
Nice. Nicest piece of history there. Yeah. So at what age did you run into the drum set? What age did you pick up a pair of sticks and start hitting stuff? Were you a little kid? Or?
I was 11 years old, turning on 12 there. That's when I started, but I wasn't that serious to begin with. Me and my brother, we used to play piano. We took piano lessons and stuff. And but I always I never really liked the piano, so I always wanted to play the drums instead for some reason. And at 12 I started, but when I became maybe 14, I started playing like every day, you know, hours every day, sort of. So it was like, but first it was like here and there.
It was like a hunger, like you were born with that passion. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I remember my father was a musician, and they played somewhere, and then I remember they took me there, and I saw the drum kit. It was sort of like an instant love, sort of. And their drummer was also like outgoing, and so I thought like the coolest guy in the band, sort of. The other ones were more introvert, and his drum kit was like a sparkling kit, and it was like really glowing in the lights and stuff. And I thought that's really what I want to do. I thought to myself,
wow. Talk
and,
about.
I was maybe eight. I was 6 years old then. But then I thought about it for till I was 11. Then I.
So what kind of music? Which band got you into a drum set? Were you already listening to music, to bands, or?
It was my father was a jazz musician, so we used to listen to that sort of stuff. You know, like regular jazz, really, and. But what really hit home for me was when I heard Deep Purple their live album, Made in Japan. That was like, I thought to myself, this is unbelievable. They play sort of a little bit jazzy and bluesy and swinging, and still it was very, very hard and heavy. So it was a combination of more swinging feel, and they had also improvisations. Stuff, and I don't know if you're familiar with that. That's kind of a long time ago, 50 years old, that album, but
of course, yeah,
52. Oh, yeah, okay, you know, you never know. People today, they're not so they're more into, more modern,
yeah.
No, so that was Deep Purple was really what made me want to be a musician.
Yeah, there's some people that have never heard of Deep Purple or Van Halen, so I guess younger generation,
yeah, Van Halen is that's really weird, but you know, because that's way later. But you know, kids now are young and stuff.
Yeah.
And I sometimes, you know, my brother played with Rainbow, and I tell people that, young people, and they're like, what? You know, I say, yeah. You know, the guy from Deep Purple, and they're like, Deep Purple. And then I sing Smoke on the Water to them, you know, and then they go, oh, that band. Because everybody knows Smoke on the Water, though.
Yeah. Wow, talk about a generation gap there. That's weird, huh?
Yeah. But you know, when we were kids, I may was the same for you.
Yep.
You know, when jazz musicians told us, you know, what are you guys doing? It's so heavy and it's so hard, and you hit so hard. And, well, what is this, you know? And I thought they are old farts, you know, what the fuck do they know? That's what I thought, you know. But I realized now, you know, they thought we were like Neanderthals, kind of, you know.
Right.
But the generation thing.
Yeah, the kids, they have a different, it's a whole different world now. But there's some kids that have an old soul, and they like old music, old rock, old metal that we like.
Luckily, yeah. And I mean, then there's some kids playing, you know, drums and guitar. They're like unbelievably fast and technical and talented and everything. But they absolutely do not have that jazzy feel or like. I mean, for my generation, we somewhere in between, I think. We, you know. But guys today, they're completely straight and on the click and on the money, whatever you call it. They're very precise.
Yeah.
But a guy like Ian Page from Deep Purple, the drummer, as an example, since we talked about Deep Purple, he's like extremely swingy and loose, kind of.
Yeah.
That has been lost now, especially with all the corrections. I mean, even with Tungsten, we have two young guys. They are my sons. I tried to get them into Deep Purple, and I forced them to listen to it when they were young, and Rainbow and Van Halen, you know, all these older bands, and they like it. And so I think they have both worlds in them somehow. They can play both styles.
Oh wow!
And for me personally, when I, you know, since they make all the songs more or less, there's sometimes these modern passages, you know, like on the double bass drums and stuff that are tricky and slightly fast and complicated. And in the beginning, I thought, oh man, this is really difficult, you know, I've never done this. But so I had to sit and practice for a few months, you know, to be able to play this stuff. But now I can do it. I mean, I'm not the best about it, but
so what was your first band? Was it with your brother, or was it each one made their own band, or?
It was with my brother. It was called English it would be phlegm or slime or something like that. You know, it wasn't punk, but we wanted to have like a name that was kind of, you know, made people not sick, but you know, it should stand out in a disgusting way somehow.
Yeah.
But it was like instrumental jazz rock or whatever.
Yeah.
Fusion, kind of. And then Jens, my brother, he was in it, and then we played. I played for a while in a band called Silver Mountain, you know, neoclassical stuff. And he pretty shortly after he came into the same band, and then Yngwie, of course.
Yeah.
And then we played in fusion bands and stuff like that. But lately, like the last 30 years or so, we've been in different bands, or last 25 years, whatever it is.
I mean, you and your brother, Jens, are extremely talented. Not because I'm talking to you, but I mean, I'm a musician here in Texas, you know, local stuff. But I do I recognize talent. And yeah, of course. Where do you think that comes from, Anders? I mean, you guys are extremely talented. You know, you're a beast on the drums.
It is,
you know.
Thanks. It's in our family, we've had. From on our father's side, there's been a lot of musicians. They're not so well known worldwide, you know. My father, kind of, or our father, kind of. And for example, one of our, I think it's second cousin or whatever you call it. It's confusing with the English and Swedish there, but not a cousin, but one step away, sort of. He used to play with on all these records on the 70s, all these disco records. I don't, Donna Summer, have you heard of her?
Of course, Donna Summer.
Donna Summer, he played on, for example, Hot Stuff. He plays all the guitar there. It's like a close relative to me and Jens. And Yes Sir, I Can Boogie, you know, these. They were European based when they recorded. Donna Summer is, of course, American, or was American, but. Since he played on these records, then that's why I bring him up. But there's a lot of other musicians that are locally known or half known or not locally known but still play on that side. Things like that, gene, the musical gene.
Wow.
Either you get it or you don't, sort of. Because and it's very strongly heritage, what do you call it? You know, when you inherit it, whatever it's called.
Yeah.
So that the musical gene is strong, and it's not like it doesn't get diluted. I think it gets either on or off when it's gotten passed on.
Yeah, I understand that. I guess what my point was, you guys are not just musicians. You guys are like very well seasoned and badass musicians. You guys are more than musicians. Maybe to the point of maybe you're half human or something. With all due respect.
It's funny, I feel almost ashamed here. Good thing you didn't put the camera on. No, yep. No, but badass, that's a cool one. I remember people in America say that. Badass, that's really positive. Thank you.
Yeah.
No, I mean, on the drums, for example, with Yngwie, his music is not that difficult to play on drums. On keyboards, yes, for sure, and on bass. But as a drummer, it wasn't that difficult, I don't think. But he was very demanding. If you didn't have musical talent, especially there in the beginning, he didn't have the patience with you, sort of.
Yeah.
I remember when we tried bass players, and if they didn't get it right away, he just, oh, man. And then he walked off and didn't say so much. And then he told us in Swedish to get rid of him, you know, like or something.
Really?
You know, yeah, when he was sober, when, you know, when English sober, he's very polite and low-key and mellow, kind of. And I think the last 20 years he hasn't drunk any alcohol at all. All the stories you hear about him is due to when he's like shit-faced and and all the misbehaving stuff, you know.
Yeah, I just interviewed.
He's actually very nice and very intelligent. Have you ever met him or?
No. I've never met him. I did speak to his current keyboard player, Nick Marino.
Yeah.
He told me the same thing. He says the same exact thing. He's demanding and.
Cool. Yeah. He's demanding musically, like I mean, he's like half a run through, you know, of the stuff, and that's all he has patience for.
Exactly.
And you know, rehearsing over and over, no way in hell. But he also, he's very witty, mature, and a nice guy actually.
You know,
he comes off as arrogant and as an asshole. It's because he's shy. Or drunk, you know, when he used to be drunk, then of course he could run his mouth like, you know, I can't believe the shit he said. But now, you know, his shyness makes him look like an arrogant guy, you know.
Yeah,
he's very shy. You
know? I get that, I understand. So, let's speak of your band, Tungsten, the Grand Inferno, dropping October 18th, correct?
Yeah, yes.
So are you excited for this record?
Yeah, I am. I think this time I like more or less all the songs. You know, usually it's like a third, you know, that I personally maybe not didn't like, or they might be too commercial, a little bit too, what do you call it, poppy or something. But this time I thought I like it, the album, more than I did with the other ones. I know people usually, I mean, you probably hear it all the time. Oh, this new album, that's the best one we've done, blah, 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 you know.
Yeah.
I don't know if this is the best one or so, but this is the one I like, personally, I like better.
So,
there's always one song or so I didn't like. I think it was the last one, it wasn't my cup of tea, really. But the other guys liked it, or two of them at least, you know.
Are your kids in charge of the project, or how much input do you have here, Anders?
We all have this four members, and we all have like 25% input, kind of. Then the guitar player, he's dedicated producer, kind of. So sometimes when we decided, like, if he says no, you know, then it's like a veto that we can't really say. Yeah, I do this, you know, because he got sick of there were four wheels, and okay, and it was always like this. This is normal for bands, of course. Oh, can you hire the toms? Can you hire? And people always moaned about their own instruments, you know.
Oh, okay.
So that's typical, and you know, so when he was mixing, and the people were, you know, so now he has a little bit more say, I think, than the rest, Nick, but. In general, I mean, if we really say no, you know, this is, which we don't really, people are not really, people are very easygoing, kind of.
Yeah.
So, it's a democracy.
Democracy, exactly.
Democracy.
How long was the process here, Anders, from the minute you guys picked up a pencil, a pen, paper, and then an instrument, to the mixing and mastering, how long was this whole process?
Do you mean on this specific album or the whole band?
This album.
In general.
This album.
The thing is, I think some of the songs were done before, and so it's like an ongoing process, kind of. We now have made a bunch of songs for the album that's not even recorded. So it's like, it's hard to say how long that process was. It was over a few years since the last album, and even a little bit before the last album was released. I think there's a lot of songs being worked on kind of all the time, in a way. I mean, we don't work on them every day, like 9 to 4 or whatever, or 9 to 5. Or it's more like here and there, but it's like an ongoing process. So it's like...
Yeah.
I thought of that today, actually, for some reason. That, for example, when we were with English band, as an example, we were touring a lot, and then suddenly the record company said, now we have to make a new record. And then people went to some sort of rehearsal studio, and we played the cover songs, and nothing was done, you know, like... and then a few songs were done, and then in the studio with Ingrid's band, songs were put together out of ideas and riffs and shit like that. It was very unserious, kind of.
Wow.
As of now, it's way more serious now. I mean, with Ingrid's band, you talked about badass. He's so badass of hell, of course. He's like one of the more badass guitarists there's ever been.
Yeah, he's another half alien, half human, for sure.
The thing is, he's unbelievably. I mean, at his prime, you know, when he was in his early 20s, he was really unbelievable. He's probably sick of practicing and keeping it up, kind of. But the fire he had when he was young, it was unbelievable. But I don't think he's more musical than we are, me and my brother. It's more or less the same, I feel. But he has practiced like crazy. When he was a kid, he practiced like 10 hours a day.
Wow.
That's a lot of time, you know. And back then, he especially here in Sweden, nobody had made it, really. It was ABBA, if you know who they are. That's like the only band that was... and that's not really a band. That's like for songwriters and singers... He sat in a closet for 10 hours a day practicing, and without even knowing that it was going to amount to anything. I mean, people now, when they have heard Yngwie, they of course or somebody, they know that it might be something if you practice, but he didn't even know it was going to be anything, and still he sat there. He is a freak. He's different.
Yeah, it's incredible. So speaking of Malmsteen, how was it working with those vocalists, Jolin Turner, Mark Bowles? How was that experience?
I mean, and Jeff Scott Soto. In my case, it was these three. Jeff Scott Soto first, and then yeah. Mark, and then Joey. Jeff Scott Soto, he was really young. He was only 18 and stuff. But he was the only American, and... we learned a lot from him. He's very talented. I mean, he's very musical.
Yes.
Jeff is, he could equally be a good keyboard player, drummer, guitar player. If he wanted to, when he was young. And Mark Bowles, he was maybe slightly more European than these other two guys. He adapted a little bit more easy to our northern ways, our northern European. I mean, there is a huge difference, strangely enough, culture wise. But Mark, I don't know, he came from Ohio, Youngstown, maybe they are a little bit more European there.
Yeah.
But then again, Jeff came from New York from the beginning, I think.
Yeah.
And Joey, too, also. But Joey was that typical. He was like 12 years older than I am, so I think he was like a rock star, sort of. We weren't. We were just, hired assholes, kind of from Sweden. But he was a rock star already. He had been with Rainbow, and he had that rock star flamboyance, whatever you call it. I mean, he wasn't. I'm not saying this in a negative way.
Yeah.
He just was a rock star. He was, you know. And then he also was like an American, Italian-American, you know, with that, you know, style, sort of.
Oh, yeah.
I think his real name is Linguido or something. And it is Linguido.
Okay.
Joseph Mark Arthur Linguido. But Jolin Turner, I mean, that's just the stage name. Joe is, of course, right.
And then from there...
But I like them both. All of them are very talented.
Yes.
Mark Bowles, we used to call him the human piano. Because if you just tell him, sing this here, you know, like you play something, and he emulates it like a piano without pitch problems or anything. He's like unbelievably on pitch, and he can sing very high. It's the highest I ever heard any singer, higher than Pavarotti and those guys, you know.
Really? Wow.
It's unbelievable. But Mark is also very musical, of course. He can play bass, and he used to play bass in Ted Nugent's band.
Okay.
That's where he came, without, I think he sang backup. And he came from Ted Nugent's band when he came to English band. That he had just quit or gotten fired or whatever happened, I don't know. So he wanted to be a pure vocalist.
Do you keep in touch?
And Joey, we keep in touch, not so much Joey, but the other two, yeah.
Really? Okay.
Joey too, though, but not so much. But if we run into him, you know, we chew the fat, and you know, it's all cool. With Joey, he is a little bit different singer than the other two. He's more bluesy and more soulful. He's not so much metal as the other ones are.
Yeah.
The other ones are pure metal singers, I would say. I mean, even though they can sing other stuff, of course, but he's more. That's what I think this Odyssey album, it sounds a little bit different, because the one Mark was on, Trilogy, he was told a lot what to sing, and he just, okay, then I'll just sing what Yngwie wants, you know, and that album was the same for everybody. Yngwie had this idea that he was going to micromanage everything.
Yeah.
And on that album, it's very cool guitar playing, I think, but I think the rest can be a little bit static, maybe. I even heard people say it was a drum machine, because I play the same patterns. That's what they wanted. That's what the producer and Yngwie wanted, so that's what I did.
Sounds great.
But, I mean, it's not like the other ones, for example, Odyssey, then we just played, there was a click track on Trilogy, and we weren't really used to that, so we felt a little bit hindered, or limited, maybe, what do you call it, you know, but in some way, a little bit stiff, maybe.
Wow.
But when we did Odyssey with Joey, he everything went completely the other way. You know, no click, more bluesy, more loose, and in the middle of everything, Yngwie had a car accident and came back like from a coma. So he was all fucked up really when we recorded that.
Wow, what a story right there! Wow.
Yeah.
Back to.
You have to stop me if I babble too much.
No, you're good. So after Malmsteen, you and your brother, you made your own band, right?
We had we went into this more or less fusion period. We played with another Swedish bass player. He used to play with Mahavishnu Orchestra with John McLaughlin and those guys. We played with him a lot and did a lot of records and tours. But we also had our own band. But that was more or less just. We recorded something in the studio, kind of. We didn't really. It wasn't really taken that serious, unfortunately. I mean, but we did it for Japanese record labels. They wanted these records. We did those, but we never toured on that. That was just like for records, kind of.
Yeah.
And after a few years, I mean, I did a lot of sessions and stuff like that in Sweden. Not. Really big things, just to, you know,
yeah,
to do something. And then I joined a band. He joined a band called Stradivarius.
Stradivarius, yeah.
And I joined one called Hammerfall.
Hammerfall, of course.
And, and then we were doing that. I was in for 15 years in Hammerfall. But then Jens is still in Stradivarius.
Yeah.
He's still there.
Is that the is that the correct pronunciation? Stradivarius?
Well, in Swedish, it's Stratovarius, but I don't know, Stradivarius, Stratovarius, it's like some sort of word joke between, you know, the violin and a Stratocaster.
Yeah.
It's like
got it.
A mix there. I don't know how to pronounce it. I think you know better than I do.
Stratovarius.
I pronounce it in English.
Stratovarius, yeah, cool. Yeah, I got it. So,
how do you say it?
Stradivarius, or yeah, I can understand.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I heard too.
But that is, yeah.
With Hammerfall, I mean, that was really cool. We did a lot of touring and a lot of cool experiences with those guys. But after 15 years, I thought to myself, I've done this kind of, for some reason. And then I played in something called a dance band. It's like, you know, when you play when people are dancing.
Okay.
Not really top 40, but old 40s. I mean, stuff from before, kind of. And that was really cool. You know, you might think gigs like that are shit, you know. And I thought that to myself a few times, too. Why am I doing this kind of? But we played a lot of four on the shore. You know what that is? When you play every single bass drum note, doom, doom, doom.
Yeah.
That's all we did for like 3-4 hours a night. And I you know, got really good with the four on the floor after that. Before, I never really done that so much. I mean, here and there. But then what we do in Tungsten now is a lot of that four on the floor. It's like the industrial sort of vibe.
Exactly. It sounds badass, and, yeah.
And but before that, I was in Manowar for 3 years.
That's right. That's right.
Manowar, of course, it's a huge band. Maybe not in America, but I mean, they're huge everywhere.
Yeah.
But in Europe, they're huge.
Yep.
They play like arenas that are 18,000 people and shit like that.
Wow.
I mean, they are humongous.
Oh, yeah.
I had recorded with them before, you know, because like I don't know if it's gonna be like a secret, you know. Sometimes you play in records and you don't really have your name there. I don't know what the deal was, but I thought it was really cool. They're really nice guys. You hear stuff about them. People sometimes tell me, you know, oh, these guys, you know, and I always tell them, you know, I tell them in a nice way. Have you actually met them, you know, or Joey? There's always Joey they talk about. And they say, no, because, you know, how stories get amplified and stuff like that. Now, I never seen anything bad with them, you know. I understand that they can be hard to negotiate with and stuff like that, and they know what they want, kind of. They've done this a long time. No, but that was great. They're very easygoing as well. They're old school musically, which I thought was cool.
Nice, wow.
And but that, with Manowar, I mean, I mean, you have to be sort of, I mean, they want you to block out like 6 months. Can you block this out 6 months, you know? Can you be in America for, you know, that long time? And it's hard to combine when you want to, when you're trying to have your own band, kind of.
Yeah.
It's difficult.
That's kind of hard. So,
It's hard because of the conflict of schedules. No, but I really like these guys. They're really nice. You know, there's nothing strange that I had to leave, sort of. I hear myself now, like, I hear my accent is strong. It's because I don't speak English, like, that often. I mean, it's like now and again, kind of. And I know the words, but I hear my accent is strong as hell. But, you know, I think it's annoying when people are trying to sound like they're Americans. You guys, you hear right away, of course, they aren't. It's ridiculous. I remember when I was there, I tried, you know, to sound, yeah, hello, I get good yourself with those mics, man. You know, I tried, you know. And people say, where are you from? Canada? Where are you from? England? You know, they hear something.
Yeah. No, you're good, It sounds good.
I thought to myself, if a Scottish person or something, you know, they speak English as well, but with a very strong Scottish accent.
Right.
They don't try to sound American, so why should I? You know, I'm Swedish, this is the way I speak. There's nothing I can do about it.
It's okay. When can we expect you guys in the U.S., Anders?
Who knows? I mean, it would be good if we could, I mean, if we would headline, it would, of course, come very little people, because nobody knows who we are, but it would be cool if we could do some sort of support thing, you know. I guess it's luck, you know, if you get those opportunities, or if somebody likes you, so, you know, it would be cool to go with, like, our friends in Sabaton, maybe, or something like that, you know, but...
Yeah, there you go. I'll catch you guys in San Antonio if I can. I'm close to San Antonio.
Oh, yeah. Franklin Gardens, we used to play with YNGWIE.
A friend of mine's seen you a couple of times, AD. He'll be listening to this for sure. He's a big fan of you guys, okay. So, yeah.
I mean, we had Pantera opening for us once there.
Yeah? Wow. Awesome, man.
And then, of course, they were like turned huge after that. I mean, 2 years later.
Of course, Pantera. So, the Grand Inferno dropping October 18th. We appreciate your time. Thank you, Anders. You're an awesome, awesome rock star. And
awesome.
I hope to see you guys in the U.S. soon.
Yeah, likewise. We would love to go there. I mean, it's a great country. I mean, the greatest country in the world.
Yeah, well, right now they're fighting for who's going to be president and stuff, but it is a good country.
Yeah, no, it is the personal thing. I mean, you know, here we don't get the thing, and we it would be weird to have an opinion about it. It's amusing. I mean,
yeah,
for us, you know, all the stuff. I mean, a guy like Trump. I mean, he's like saying things. It's really funny, you know. I think I like when he speaks.
yep.
You know, like
it's funny.
He,
I know.
He seems to be like a good businessman and a bully, kind of at the same time.
yeah, that's true.
You know, like we used to have a manager like him, and you know, he was great. But and the new one they have, the lady, I don't know. She seemed to like jazz records. I saw, and I thought that was nice. And then she didn't know how many people lived in America. And I thought to myself, that's really weird. I mean, how is that possible? I mean, I know, you know, kind of. I think it's 330 million, maybe. Just guessing, but in that ballpark. And she thought 220 million had died in Corona. And I thought that's almost the whole population, you know.
That's true.
Biden, I mean, that was sad. I mean, he was losing his mind, literally.
yes,
it wasn't his fault.
I saw that poor guy. Wow. I mean,
yeah, but he's gone.
Getting older, huh? Yep. Yeah.
Yeah, that happens. You know, what can you do? It's like for us here in Europe, we get fed. I mean, from the news, what they, you know, a lot of people here are very left wing kind of. So what you hear, you people here, you should hate Trump and stuff. That's always like. You know, I always want to go the other way then, you know, because I think that people's Swedish news shouldn't tell us what to think about the American election, I think. That should be left to you guys to decide. We should just sit and be neutral and watch, kind of. So I think it's strange. But here they are, I don't know. This used to be, I mean, it's no one, what do you call it? Used to be a very socialist country. I mean, it is still. It has very good things in that, but it's also slightly like Russia, if you really make it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like Russia, of course, but it's more like Russia than America, is for sure. We're like sort of in between.
Somewhere between, yeah.
Which is kind of weird. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, back to tungsten. How does it feel being on stage with your kids? How did that first feel when you first got on stage with your family?
The first time I thought it was kind of strange, and I think they did too. And now it's very normal. I mean, it's I don't think these are my kids, because they are adults, and something happens when kids go through puberty. I think then they turn more into their own human beings. It's not, they are your kids, of course, but somehow they are also more. They are individuals or whatever you call it. They are, at least that's how I feel. I of course help them, and I also, if they like drink too much, which they don't, but I think it's not so fun for them to get drunk when I'm around, sort of, you know. It's like, who wants to drink with your parents?
Yeah.
And but I sometimes go to bed before they do, you know, like an old fart kind of. I go there. Let's say 1 or 2 o'clock or something, and they want to stay up till 5-6 in the morning. And I might say stuff like, I used to say, like, okay, don't drink too much now, you know. But it's so unnecessary, because they are doing what they want anyway. So now I don't say that sort of thing anymore.
They're
and
adults.
On the way to gigs, or I used to really try to educate them and discipline them or whatever, you know, like with all sorts of. Moral things and this and that, and do this and remember that, you know. And that sort of has stopped as well, because I don't have to anymore. The thing is, nowadays they might discipline, is a strange word, but they might educate me or tell me to not misbehave or behave strange and shit like that. They feel embarrassed sometimes, they have said, you know, over my 80s behavior, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not like trashing dressing rooms and stuff like that or anything, but I might be saying weird things in hotels, you know, like trying to be funny and stuff, and they think it's just embarrassing, you know.
Really?
I remember Nick, the guitar player, he was asked, I overheard it in an interview, how is it to play with your father, with Anders, a legend, and blah, blah, blah. And he said, yeah, well, okay, he might be a legend to you, but to me, he's my father. How would you think it would be to play in a band with your father, or your parents or something, he said to the interviewer. And they went, oh, yeah, I never thought of that. Yeah, that's right, you know. But I think it's, for them, I mean, a lot of things they are not, you know, like landmines they haven't stepped on, you know, like record contracts and things like that. If it wouldn't be for me, they would have shit deals, kind of, and they would be like taking advantage of much more.
Exactly.
Because in the beginning, you don't really know, and you don't know when to, if it's okay to say no or say yes or whatever, you know. Or in my case, I hired lawyers to look over the record contracts and stuff, and not really lawyers, but music industry giants here in Europe, kind of.
Okay.
That are old friends, and that helped us, but they wouldn't have thought of that, you know. You know how?
Yeah.
So inexperienced guys, they do dumb things sometimes.
Yeah, you have the experience, and the younger you are. But of course, there's no experience there. You're learning as you go. But speaking of labels, Anders, I ask everybody that I interview, the question is, a record label or no record label, can a new band make it out there in the music business with no record label, just with social media, or do they need a record label? What's your stand on that?
Well, in my case, for me, or for us, It wouldn't work without the record label. We are too lazy, maybe it might be the wrong word, but we don't have the connections, and we don't have not me either, you know. And so for us, 100% it's better with a record label, because they work this all day long, and that's what they do, you know. And we used to have this metalcore label before on the first three records, and they were great, you know, in all sorts of ways, except that we were a little bit wrong musically for their label. So now we have a label that's much more in our style, and I think that makes everything easier.
True, yeah.
But I think it's hard to say, though. I'm sure there are bands that can make it on social media if they work on it, and if they are dedicated and stuff. It's for sure not impossible these days, I think.
Right.
But for us, it wouldn't have worked. For us, we must have a label because we are I don't know, inexperienced with it, or a little bit too, I don't know, something we're not doing right, I think. We wouldn't. No, it's because they know all these guys, and they put it on the right playlists and stuff, what's important these days, you know.
Speaking of your new album, The Grand Inferno, Anders, is there something there you would change if you had the chance to? I know it's mixed and mastered, you can't go backwards. Are you completely satisfied with this album, or would you like to change something on there if you had the chance?
Not really. No, not really. No, I can't think of anything. Sometimes, especially when I was younger, and I used to think, listen to albums and think, this should be done, and this should be mixed different, and this should be that, and that, this. But as now, I think, when you mix something, you have to forget about it, it's done. That's a time document, kind of. There's nothing, you know how some bands remix their albums and try and stuff like that.
Oh yeah.
Most of them are not happy. I don't know. It's, sometimes when I hear remastered or remixed albums, sometimes it sounds worse.
Yeah.
For some reason, I don't know why that is. Maybe it's because you're so used to the old way it sounded.
The original sound, yeah. Yeah, some bands do that.
Yeah, and they do. I think they have, you know, over the years thought, oh, I wish we would have. You know, Metallica, for example, I don't know if they remixed that album, but everybody complained about where there was no bass on it or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Did they remix that, or?
I think somebody, not them, but somebody added the bass in there. So I don't know who it was. I don't think it was them. But yeah, it sounds
okay.
It sounds weird. Yeah, yeah, with the bass.
But I think that album. I mean, it was maybe dry, whatever you call it. I mean, not so much reverb. I don't even remember. But to me, it was cool, anyways.
Injustice. Yeah, yeah. Of course, awesome stuff. Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. Also, another thing with Lars. You know, he's from Denmark actually. He's like, he used to live 40 minutes away from here. It's a different country, but. Nowadays, there's a bridge between them. I think he's an awesome drummer. I mean, yeah. I you know, haven't heard how he sounds these days. People tell me, yeah, well, now he's not. But what he did for thrash metal and metal in the 80s, it's a huge contribution, I think, to the drummers and the aggression and his style, sort of. I really like the first albums.
Oh yeah, I'm a fan myself of Metallica, old and new. Yeah. I like the new stuff too. What do you listen to?
I haven't heard but that yellow one they just released, or whatever, was a year ago or whatever. I thought that was really cool.
72 the seasons. Yeah. 72 seasons.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. I don't know, but to me that was really cool. I really liked it.
Oh
but,
yeah.
I don't know what it sounded like. Sort of they went back to the old stuff a little bit more.
So what do you listen to, Anders, when you're not sitting behind a drum kit? Or with your family, what kind of music do you listen to? Do you still listen to rock, or do you go out there and listen to other stuff?
I usually have, you know, Spotify, you know, and I flip through all sorts of different stuff. It can be fusion, you know, it can be thrash metal or technical progressive metal. It can be old stuff or new stuff. It doesn't matter as long as it's good somehow. Well, what's good and bad is hard to define, but it's good to me. I used to play with last summer. I played with Uli Roth, Uli John Roth, or whatever you heard say it in English.
Of course, legend.
That was really cool because he was a big influence on all of us, and especially on Yngwie. And we listened so much to him. It was cool to play with him, actually.
Wow.
but then again, the same thing there with Tungsten. He was going to do this long tour in Europe with your, and then he was going to America for 7 weeks, like this spring. And 7 weeks, you know, we that's when we were dealing with a lot of Tungsten stuff.
You guys have a gig on August 31st, right?
Yeah, we do. Yeah, that's here in Sweden. Yeah, we do. Yeah.
So, how many new songs are you guys putting on the set list there?
We put on three, I think, of the new ones. Yeah, three.
Oh, wow.
There's one coming tomorrow. There's a new one coming tomorrow. and that's, that one's going to be included too. I don't know why we do that, but because this where we're playing is a festival for, like, they have ordinary people there, whatever you call it. Normal, not normal, but not it's not a metal festival. It's like...
Yeah, normal.
Festivals, a normal festival, or like, or they have all sorts of bands.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it seems like we are tending to be popular with normal people. I don't know if that's good or bad, but I guess it's good. But
that's good. I mean, that's good stuff. I mean,
I guess. But
yeah,
metal people might say, "Oh, they're selling out," but then again, we're not that famous that people can start saying that.
I think my opinion and my two cents. I think Tungsten sounds like something like Rammstein. No offense.
Yeah.
It's a good thing to me.
No.
Good thing.
Yeah.
Good stuff. Maybe that's why you're hitting a bigger audience there, because Rammstein is big everywhere, basically. So, yeah, there you go. Normal.
They are a huge influence, especially on the bass player that makes a lot of songs. With Hammerfall, we opened for them a few times on big stadiums.
Really?
Twice only, but and my kids were there both times, and they were young, you know, and it made a huge impact on them, you know, to see them guys, and they were like I think Tungsten has a lot of influence from them.
Yeah, you can hear it.
Or the style. Or especially, you know, the song that comes out tomorrow, whenever it is. Maybe it's now 12 o'clock tonight. I don't know how it works. The video comes in the afternoon. You know how they are.
Yeah, it's going to drop. You got a video tomorrow. Is it tomorrow or coming out tomorrow?
It's tomorrow. Our time. Your time, too. For you, it will be... What are you, 7 or 8 hours behind us? 7, right?
About 7, yeah. 8.
What time is it there now?
Right now, it's about 3 p.m., something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have 2:53, yeah, p.m.
Yeah, so 7 hours. Yeah, so you're coming here at 5 p.m. here. The song is called Lullaby, and it's coming... But that song has a Rammstein vibe to it.
Nice.
Since you mentioned that, I think that sounds like it.
Well, you guys are heading the right way.
I don't know if you have the whole album, if they've sent it to you or not. But
Yes, I did. I heard it. It's awesome. I got it from the label. It's awesome.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
There's a few Rammstein songs. There's another one. It's called Me, Myself, My Enemy, I think. And that also has to say that sort of vibe. And now when I think about it, it's just like 3 songs that has that vibe. Why not?
You guys are heading the right direction. I mean, as I said, Rammstein is huge anywhere in the world, basically. And if you guys you just mentioned playing in a normal festival, that means you guys are hitting a chord with normal people, right? Rock and non-rock. Yeah. So that's a good thing.
We can't be copying them, though. The funny thing, they had a song where they actually took something from our album and sampled it.
Really?
It's a small world. We thought to ourselves, what the fuck? You know, Rammstein has taken sampled something from our record. You know?
Really?
It was a few years ago. And one of our, I think, our first record or second or something. But I mean, they, you know, a big friend of ours, you used to have a band together with their singer,
okay.
Peter Tektgren. I don't know if you know who that is, from Pain and Hypocrisy. He's the,
oh, yes. Peter?
Peter, yeah, exactly. Peter had a band together with Till Lindemann, and you know, it's a small world, that's for sure.
Wow, very cool stuff. Wow.
Especially, I mean, the European bands, I mean, they are, of course, huge. I mean, they play... stadiums, like you know, the unbelievable size stadiums, but still, I mean, these guys are normal guys. They sit and listen to normal stuff, you know.
Yeah, well, I heard the stuff. I heard the new Tungsten album, the Grand Inferno. People are gonna like it for sure. For people listening, where can they pre-order it, Anders? Where can people pre-order this?
I don't know. There are links and stuff on social media where they can pre-order. I don't really know. More than these links, kind of, you know, they have this pre-order here link, you know. Maybe they can go into the record label. We say RPM for short.
RPM.
Maybe they can go in.
Rainy Phoenix Music. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Well,
complicated name, maybe, but that's Germans.
RPM. RPM for people
listening. RPM is easier to say.
Yeah. You guys are going places for sure, Anders. It's some good stuff, and for sure you guys are going. You'll be like Rammstein at that level, or more for sure. Well, mark my words. You got to. You do have some good stuff.
If we make it like 1% of them, it would be good because they are huge, of course.
Oh yeah.
But it would be.
Oh yeah, for
it's
sure.
It's like Metallica. It's funny when we were like teenagers, we used to send cassettes to them when they were like in San Francisco. Kirk and Lars and those. We were trading tapes and stuff.
Trading tapes.
And I remember we met them and we played in Oakland once with the English band, and they were playing after us at a huge festival. And Lars, of course, is Danish, and we can speak Scandinavian to each other. Suddenly they just became huge over one day. It was really cool, I think, you know, when they...
Stadiums.
When they, I don't know, was it the fourth album they really... What was it? And Justice. Was that the one they really... Which one was it?
I think they blew up with the Black Album, 91, but they did a lot of noise with Injustice, you're right, with the video for One and all that.
Yeah, exactly. But even before the, that, Masters of Puppets.
Master of Puppets, yeah.
That was like a thrash milestone. I mean, it doesn't really get much better than that. I think that's a really cool album.
I agree.
I mean, the other ones as well.
I agree. Mastery is one of the best.
Have you met Lars and those guys ever?
No, not yet. I haven't had that luck. Yeah.
Well, you should. Really cool guys. I mean, really down to earth, I think.
Really? Wow, very cool. Who is...
Especially Kirk. Yeah, I mean, Kirk is like... He's almost shy, you know? He's like... Lars is very outgoing and talks a bunch and stuff like that. But the other guys are kind of silent.
I read that James is kind of shy too.
Oh yeah, he is, yes. I remember we once hung out like a night and he hardly spoke at all. Lars, on the other hand, he was like, bah, bah, bah. Lars thought Yngwie was annoying. So, you know, when Yngwie went to the toilet, he broke his glasses. I mean, he just threw them on the floor and he looked at us and just laughed. I thought, oh man. You know, like,
really? Wow, what a story.
I thought Lars is, he's like half the size of Yngwie, you know.
Yeah.
Yngwie would, of course, not beat him up or anything, but still, if he saw that, he would be very disappointed, of course, Yngwie. But Lars thought Yngwie talked too much.
That's what I heard, yeah. He's the spokesman of the band.
Lars is, he's for sure like a leader, sort of.
Yeah.
He has ideas, and he's like, you know.
Yeah, I read that Lars and James are the owners and directors of the band. But yeah.
Yeah.
I guess.
For sure.
Speaking wise, I guess Lars.
One time, me and Lars and my brother, we went to the Rainbow. It's a bar in Los Angeles.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was like in the middle of the summer. And it was like, 110 degrees outside or whatever. Like, you know, hot as hell.
Yeah.
And they had AC on there, and we stood there with sweatpants, and we didn't have hairspray, and we just stood there, and we all like spoke Swedish, Danish, kind of, which is very similar. Fucking assholes, you know, like, let's do something. And so we found the control for the AC and turn on the heater instead. You know, we turned it on. You know how the, in America you have that round thing, you can like a dial, kind of.
Yeah, yeah.
It's all different here, but. That controls the whole place.
Yeah.
We turned it on maximum, and we stood there. Everybody's hairs, you know, the hairspray and all the makeup for everybody. It was running. People, oh, it's goddamn, it's so hot in here, man. What the fuck? You know, and we stood there. So it was really funny. And then we went back a few days later and tried to do it again. You know, let's go back, you know. Then they had put it underneath a plastic cover with a padlock on it. They had realized somebody had fucked with it, you know. So we couldn't do it again.
So, wow, what a cool story.
Measured it. It was cool because that sort of shows that Lars is just a normal person like everybody else. You know, now of course they are rock gods, you know.
Yeah.
Beyond rock gods, so I don't know what they are. They're super humans. But they're actually normal. They're normal people, of course, you know.
Real cool guys. That's what I see the interviews and the backstage stuff, and yeah, that's, you're right, that's, they're just regular people. But
they are, especially another, I mean, Lars stories, of course, it's maybe strange to talk about. You have to edit out all this bullshit, but maybe, but I remember we were in Tokyo once in Japan, and we were gonna go, and we had a day off with the English band, and we were gonna go and check Metallica out, and Lars saw us coming in the venue like from a huge distance, and he threw an ice cube at me like and but by accident or chance or whatever, because it came into the, I had a shirt on, you know, tried to look decent for some reason, I don't know why, but it went in the side pocket, or we call it on the chest pocket, you know, some shirts have pockets for some reason on you know,
yeah,
on your chest. I don't know why that is, what we're supposed to have there, but the ice cube went in there. I didn't realize it. I just thought, so afterward it started, you know, becoming wet and stuff. I thought, what the fuck, you know, cold, and it was just by chance. But They played the same venue we played. I mean, it wasn't. It was big, but not. It wasn't too huge. You know, yeah. It was maybe 3 or 4 thousand people, maybe.
What is this? 85, 86, 87?
I would imagine it was 86. That's what I think. It kind of might have been 88, but I think 86 actually.
Okay. Wow. Any artists that you haven't met? Maybe one of your idols that you want to meet? Maybe something on your bucket list?
Bucket list. Strangely enough, I would like to meet a bass player called Mark King. It's a British bass player that plays funk, kind of. He plays in a band called Level 42.
Okay.
I mean, that's not metal at all, but it's like some of this stuff is it's really.
I'll check it out.
And annoying, kind of.
Level 42.
Some of it is cool. You know, you might hate it because most metal people do. But
I'm okay. I'm okay with other stuff. Yeah.
His bass playing is that's something I like. I mean, before that, I used to think Alan Holdsworth was like somebody, you know, guitar player. And then we actually met him and we did the record as well. He died unfortunately. But
yeah. Any words you want to say to your fans, Anders?
It was hard to come up with something, of course. But to this, what can I say? I feel prepared something because this question always comes, and I always fumble for words every time. But what a natural reaction is like, the fans are why we can follow our dream and do what we really love. So without the fans, of course, we are really nothing. So a huge thanks to the people that listen to us.
Yes.
I should try to remember that because, you know, then again, it's cooler when it's spontaneous, I guess, like it was now. Another guy, you know, that another band I always liked was Van Halen.
Oh, but, yeah.
I think the
Legends.
Yeah, exactly. Really cool. And I don't know when they. These two brothers are from the Netherlands, from Holland.
That's true.
They must have come. They must have come as young kids, I think, because they when they spoke English, did they speak? They spoke without the accents, or do you know? Or
you
could tell, right?
They had to learn English here when they came to America, because they're from Holland, right? They had to learn at
exactly.
First, yeah, and then eventually they learned, right? But yeah, they came on.
But can you, for example, when you listen to them, can you hear that they have an accent, or do they sound exactly American?
They sound American, yeah. I guess
okay,
probably because they were here since kids. Probably they had their whole lives here,
exactly.
Basically.
That's why.
I know this much. I know their dad was a musician on a cruise ship, and that's how he got his family over here. I read about that. They came from Holland on a cruise ship where their dad was playing there with the band. I forget the name of the dad, but yeah, that's the story. It's online. So that's how they ended up over here in California somehow.
And I mean, really cool band, I think. Really, you know, when we first heard it, you know, it was like before and after you heard that. It changed everything, kind of.
Oh, yeah.
When you heard that first record.
A great band. Great band with Roth or Hagar. What'd you think of Hagar years?
You know how it is. When you first, in my case, heard all these first albums, and then the Hagar years, I was too old to like sort of follow it and be a fan, kind of. We were touring a lot already, and I just heard it here and there on the radio. So for me, David Lee Roth was the one I like more.
But, yeah.
Sammy Hagar, of course, sings more proper, whatever you call it. But I think David Roth had more of an output or what do you call it? There was something about him.
Yeah.
Somehow. I don't know.
More fame, more outgoing, more hits, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And his voice was more raspy, and even though Sammy Hagar is a more musician's type, and more. Yeah. Correct singer, I think.
Oh yeah.
But Dave is more rock star and more fun, maybe. and more ideas.
I'm a fan of both.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
we met Dave Lee Roth a bunch of times, and you know, he's like, he's exactly like you think. Have you met? I don't know if you met him, but he's very friendly and everything. But
never have, no.
Man, he can talk, and you know, it's important. I just stood there, like, listening. I thought this is really cool. We stood in the bathroom stall, me and Yngwie and him once, and just talked, you know, and I thought to myself, you know. 1.5 years ago, I was in the Swedish Marines. Now I stand with Dave, Diamond Dave. What the fuck is happening here?
Wow.
I thought, this is unbelievable.
Incredible. Incredible change.
Yeah, it was. You know, you can imagine. I mean, yeah, I don't know if you've been in the military, but it's harsh. You know, it's not so nice.
It never was. Yeah, yeah. I heard stories. Yeah, my respects. Yep.
Yeah, you know how the stories you hear, it's horrific. You know, you see these movies when they scream and yell at you. That's what they do.
Oh,
it's
wow.
To intimidate you, to make you, you know, follow orders. I mean, it's. But Diamond Dave, he had two dwarves outside as guards, and he said the karate dwarves, you know, and I thought, you know.
Really?
They must be really lethal, I thought, you know, if they are. I didn't. Know so much about karate and stuff then. I do now because I've done it now many years. But then I thought if somebody knew karate, that was just they were as good as a gun. I thought, you know, they were, but that's not how it is, of course.
Wow.
Even if a dwarf knows is a black belt, you know, a normal guy can just kick him in the face. You know, it doesn't.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah, so Anders,
it's like a weight thing.
Anders, I won't keep you much longer. You're a great chat. You have some awesome stories, and we should do it again. We'll try it again in a couple of months.
Anytime. It's really nice. And sorry if it was too here and there, whatever you call it, like back and forth, but I guess...
yeah, appreciate it.
I thought it was... You, like, evoke a bunch of memories somehow that I never really spoke about before. This Lars Ulrich story, I've never said that, and Diamond Dave either. So
Fan.
He was memory lane.
Fans are gonna love this.
Really nice.
Fans are gonna love this. I appreciate the stories and very cool, Anders. You're a cool guy. Maybe sometime I'll see you and see you guys in the U.S. Appreciate that, man.
In case we ever play somewhere and you are close by and have time, contact us before and we hang out and have lunch or something. And
for sure. A legend. In his own and in our metal rock history, for sure, do you concur? That is my proposition. And Anders Johansson is a complete half human, half hybrid of some type. Just a joke, of course, but he is super, super talented, as you guys know by now. And if you don't know who he is, check it out. Anders Johansson. Extraordinary drummer for Tungsten, TUNGSTEN. And I think they kind of sound like, I want to say Rammstein, which is a plus. And he talks about that in this interview that you guys just heard, right? Where they are getting these regular other festivals, non-metal, I guess, where they are being compared to as Rammstein, I think. I'm not sure. But anyways... Thank you, Anders, for the great chat and all these awesome stories working with Malmsteen and going back to your career and speaking of Deep Purple and all these different musicians and your influences. So much appreciated on behalf of your friend James from the state of Texas in the U.S. of A. Planet Earth. Don't forget to keep it metal.
That metal interview.